when my best is just not good enough, when the clouds turn dark and gray. I know you've always made a way, so I will look this storm in the eye. I won't fear, for you're on my side. My first hope, my last word, now and forever. Let it rain, let it pour, I will sing. All you've ever been is good to me. At my very worst, you show me love. When I turn my back, you don't give up. Yeah, you meet my needs, you always have. Steady and strong through the good and the bad. I will look this storm in the eye. I won't fear, for you're on my side. My first hope, my last word, now and forever. Let it rain, let it pour, I will sing. All you've ever been is good. I won't fear, for you're on my side. My first hope, my last word, now and forever. Let it rain, let it pour, I will sing. Oh, let it rain, let it pour, I will sing. All you've ever been is good to me.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Thank you for joining us for our final Wednesday evening during Lent services. I appreciate that you're here and having the opportunity. I appreciate worshiping with you this evening. I don't have any other announcements other than you'll notice that the screens are not going to be in use, and that's because the internet is down at this time. And so the one song that we have for this evening, At the Cross, we do all know it. We've done it several times, but if you're unfamiliar with it, you're welcome to join us in heart and spirit as we worship. But if you do know it, we ask that you would still please continue to sing along with us for that song. We'll begin our service this evening in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Would you please join me in opening prayer? Jesus, we are grateful for this day. No matter what it has brought in or what it lacked to bring, we are grateful for the opportunity to have another day to worship you, to thank you for your grace, to grow closer to you in word and spirit, and have the opportunity to live. Thank you for life, and thank you for being the source of that life. We ask, Lord, that you would use this service to glorify your name, and that you might strengthen the heart and souls of the weary and the believer who are here this evening. We love you. Amen. Let's join together, and would you please rise and stand if you are able, and sing together our opening hymn this evening, Lead Me to Calvary, number 474. Let us now bow before the Lord and confess our sins with the confession found on page 2. Almighty God, our Maker and Redeemer, we poor sinners confess to you that we are by nature sinful and unclean, and that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. Therefore, we flee for refuge to your infinite mercy and ask you, for Christ's sake, grant us forgiveness of all our sins, and by your Holy Spirit, increase in us true knowledge of you and of your will and true obedience to your word, to the end that by your grace we may come to eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please receive the declaration of grace and absolution this evening. If this be your sincere confession, and if with penitent hearts you earnestly desire the forgiveness of your sins for the sake of Jesus Christ, God, according to his promise, forgives you all your sins. And by the authority of God's word and by the command of our Lord Jesus Christ, I can declare to you that God, through his grace, has forgiven all your sins. In the name of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Please be seated. The scripture lessons this evening. The first lesson comes from Amos chapter 8, verses 9 through 14, and is the message text for this evening. Reading in Jesus' name. It will come about in that day, declares the Lord, that I will make the sun go down at noon and make the earth dark in broad daylight. Then I will turn your festivals into mourning and all your songs into lamentations. And I will bring sackcloth on everyone's loins and baldness on every head. I will make it like a time of mourning for an only son, and the end of it will be like a bitter day. Behold, days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will send a famine on the land, not a famine for bread or a thirst for water, but rather for a hearing the words of the Lord. People will stagger from sea to sea and from the north even to the east. They will go out and fro to seek the word of the Lord, but they will not find it. The second lesson is from Isaiah chapter 13, verses 9 through 16. Behold, the day of the Lord is coming, cruel with fury and burning anger, to make the land a desolation, and he will exterminate its sinners from it. For the stars of heaven and their constellations will not flash forth their light. The sun will be dark when it rises, and the moon will not shed its light. Thus I will punish the world for its evil, and the wicked for their iniquity. And I will also put an end to the arrogance of the proud, a base to the haughtiness of the ruthless. I will make mortal man scarcer than pure gold, and mankind the gold of Ophir. Therefore, I will make the heavens tremble, and the earth will be shaken from its place at the fury of the Lord of hosts in the day of his burning anger. And it will be like that of a hunted gazelle, or like sheep when none to gather them. They will each turn to his own people, and each one flee to his own land. Anyone who is found will be thrust through, and anyone who is captured will fall by the sword. Their little ones also will be dashed to pieces before their eyes. Their houses will be plundered and their wives ravished. Here ends the reading. We'll sing together. You want the children first? Okay. We'll start now then by having the children come forward for the lesson this evening. Before or after?
The object of our lesson tonight is upset. All right. I have a question. Do you believe that Jesus can save you?
Yes.
Everybody believe that?
For it is by grace you have been saved through faith. And this not from yourselves, it is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life.
Acts 16:31.
Believe in the Lord Jesus and you will be saved.
We faithfully trust. Jesus said in John 14:1.
Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. Surely this is our God. We trusted in him and he saved us. This is the Lord. We trusted in him. Let us rejoice and be glad in his salvation.
And our AFLC Catechism, question number 149, asks, what do you mean when you say, I believe in Jesus Christ? It means?
Trusting in Jesus Christ with all my heart, I surrender myself to him as my only Savior from sin and death, and the power of Satan.
And my 60-year-old catechism, so it was over 60 years ago that I was in confirmation, says trust is required for faith. Now, I spent some time looking up these three words, believe, faith, and trust. I looked at the catechism, the Bible, went to the dictionary, the Bible dictionary, and I even looked at Wikipedia. And these words are often used so believe, the synonym for believe is to have trust, to have faith. The synonym for that is complete trust, unquestionable belief. Trust, synonym for that, to believe and have faith. But I happen to think there's a little bit of difference in these meaning of these words. Okay, Seth, do you believe that Seth is able to catch you and keep you from falling?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Would you trust Seth to catch you and keep you?
Yes.
All right, Brendan, let's try you out. Okay, you stand in front of him, turn around, and fall backwards. Very good. Very good. Anybody else want to try it? Okay. Number 376, and number 576. So we are going to sing 376.
All right. This evening's text and message come from Amos chapter 8, verses 9, and it's actually 9 through 12. And this is in that series then that we're following through during Lent here, which is Lament in Lent. And the idea is to have the focus of our Lenten series and our Lenten time be on our need and our position in compared to Christ, the focus of our sin and the need for a Savior. Because of that, it tends to, if you haven't noticed, tends to be a lot of law that we've been reading through. And today is no different. I'm not going to read through it again, but would you please join me in prayer as we begin? Lord God, this is your time to speak to us through your word. May your Spirit bring us the rich nourishment of your gospel. Lord, maybe we be reminded also of the importance of the law that helps us to recognize the need for that gospel. Pray, Lord Jesus, that you would be glorified. Lord Jesus, you speak in your holy and precious name. Amen. It begins with that statement that we hear often. It will come about in that day. Later on, we also say, behold, the days are coming. When we hear that phrase, it's often referred to as the great and terrible day of the Lord. In that day, the great day of the Lord. And you also often have heard me talk about that. And in that day, the day of judgment, there is also glory. So while those who do not believe are to fear the day of the Lord, those who believe are excited for the day of the Lord and what it brings. As it begins, it says, declares the Lord God, that I will make the sun go down at noon and make the earth dark in broad daylight. Then I will turn your festivals into mourning, and all your songs into lamentation. I'm hoping that as we move, you'll begin to see some of the terminology that's similar, that's used in reference to point to that moment that Christ is on the cross. That's important, because that was a great and terrible day. The day that Christ was on the cross was a day of judgment. In confirmation class today, we talked about the very important fact of recognizing what our sin is and the need for daily repentance, but also the difference between I'm just going to forgive something out of kindness and the forgiveness in which we receive from the Lord. So I was playing with a friend of mine in the backyard, and I was swinging a baseball bat. Yeah, you can imagine, you know, how easily bats fly and then smash your friend's shin, right? That just happens. My friend ran home because he was hurt, and then he didn't come back for a long time, and I was worried he was mad at me. So I went over to his house, and he was just fine. He was just drinking milk. And he had acted like nothing ever happened, just as if it was never even happened, just forgave me. And we never brought it up again either. That's not the kind of forgiveness that we get from Christ. See, the forgiveness that we have from Christ is that it's forgotten because it was paid for. It's not forgotten because of kindness. It was because a transaction took place and the debt that was due had been paid. One of the things that I hope that you begin to see when you hear in texts that it begins to talk about the great and terrible day of the Lord and the judgment that comes. Many times we look at those places of Scripture and we automatically go to the second coming. And often, what will it be like for tribulation per se? Or how are the end times going to look? And we know that in the end times when Christ comes, it gets worse before it gets better. And so sometimes we read those passages of the Scripture and we think to ourselves of how bad it will get and what the tribulation will be like on me and all of those things. But I would like it if at some times when you read those places and you hear of those things, that you recognize that the judgment that God speaks of against evil and sin, all of that, every ounce of that was poured out on Christ. Christ took that judgment. I learned something this week in studying for this passage. At the end of the first part here of the chapter 10, it says, at the beginning of the verse 10, it says, I will turn your festivals into mourning. You can imagine then the contrast that is being made from a point of joyfulness to a point of sorrow. All of your songs into lamentations. And I kind of wondered a little bit about the word lamentation here. And I found something that I wasn't expecting to find. The word in its use at this point is speaking of a funeral song. So what it's saying is that all of your songs that you sing, I'm going to change them into funeral songs. For me, that this week, that hit me pretty hard. It's hard sometimes to want to sing in a funeral, isn't it? It's hard to be cheerful and joyful at the loss. The thing that I wasn't expecting to find is this. The word that's used, that we translate as lamentation, when it's used as a proper pronoun, means Cain. Chew on that this next week. The base of the word for lamentation is Cain, the son of Adam and Eve. It goes on, I will bring sackcloth on everyone's loins and baldness on every head. These are expressions of sorrow, of mourning. And in some cases, we probably read through that and it doesn't stick very well with us because we don't express mourning well, do we? It used to be that you would express mourning and maybe you had a season of mourning where it was customary to wear black for many days on end as you mourned, as an expression of mourning. During the time of David, to express, you could tear your clothes. In this case, you could shave your hair. You wear sackcloth as an expression to others that you are in deep mourning, that what is being, that is happening emotionally on the inside can be expressed on the outside. How well do we do that in today's society? You will never see what really is going on my inside on the outside. When you ask, I give you some, but never all of it, right? Isn't that the case with most of us? We're not going to share everything. We'll share just enough. What would happen if we shared it all? Maybe we would walk around with our hair shaved. Maybe we would walk around in sackcloth more often. Some of you are bald already and you don't have a choice, so. The end of verse 10 here. And I will make it like a time of mourning for an only son. That phrase of for an only son is a specific phrase that's used to express the idea of what it's like to mourn when all you have is the one son and that they have passed. Furthermore, it's very directly connected to Christ. Zechariah 12:10 says this, so they will look on me whom they have pierced. They will mourn for him as one who mourns for an only son. Verse 9 and verse 10 are absolutely pointing towards the judgment that is going to come and be placed on Christ on that day. I will make it like a time of mourning for an only son, and at the end of it will be like a bitter day. Behold, days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will send a famine on the land, not a famine for bread or a thirst for water, but rather for hearing the words of the Lord. People will stagger from sea to sea and from the north and even to the east. They will go out to and fro to seek the word of the Lord, but they will not find it. Dennis, has there been very many days in your life? Yes, I'm... Dennis, there's not been many days in your life, I'm sure, where the word of God hasn't been present, right? This area has been like that for most of you for a long time, hasn't it? Your life began in this church. Your life was connected to the events of this church. You didn't miss many Sundays hearing the word of God in this church. I want you for a moment to imagine, wonder, what would your life be like? What would the outcome have been in your life? Dennis, what kind of man would you have been had the Word of God not ever been present in your life? What would this area have looked like if the Word of God would never have been found present here? I wouldn't be alive, I can tell you that for certain. If the Word of God had not come to me in my life, I wouldn't be here, and none of my children would have been here. There's a warning, and this is the same warning that we find in our life of this point of no return. I don't know where the line is where we wake up one day, where the first day we're believing, we're trusting, and then another day we wake up and we don't know where the road is. We can't see the trail any longer. We've wandered so far that we can't see the stars and we have no bearing. I don't know where that line is. So I can't tell you when this will happen. Whether it's to be taken literally or figuratively. Whether it's been fulfilled or yet to have come to pass. Those things are irrelevant. Because without the word of the Lord, we have nothing. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of the Lord. Do you ever feel short, shallow in faith? I do. I've had plenty of nights as I've gone to bed questioning what kind of father I am. How well of a pastor had I actually been? Wondering if God is listening and paying attention, if he sees what is actually happening in my life and if he cares. If I'm a pastor and I've had these things and felt these things, then most certainly at some point in time in your life, you've wondered the same thing. What would happen if in those moments where we are grasping for something in the dark, that there was no light? What if in those moments where we're searching for hope and there's only moments and seconds yet to live, and there was nothing to grasp because it could not be found? So, is that this day? No. So while you have it, grab it. Do not let the word of God go. Do not let the cross of Christ pass beyond you. Stay at the foot of the cross. Believe, have faith, trust. Because we have it still now. Because it says here there will be a day, and I don't know when, that you might search for it and cannot find it. Christ's love for us drew him to the cross, where his love was poured out. But as it was poured out, the wrath of God was poured out as well. The fullness of the judgment of God against all sin for all mankind that would ever have lived was bore on the cross. So, I ask for you to believe. And I ask for you, the next time you begin to read a text or hear a text that begins to talk about the great and terrible day of the Lord, and that you begin to see judgment that is coming against sin, that while it may be yet to come, recognize that all judgment has been passed already on Christ, and the weight that that cross was that he bore. It expresses how much he truly loved us and loves us still. Let us pray. Jesus, oh, how you love us. What great, great love you have bestowed. We are thankful. Words cannot express what it means to stand in the glory of the cross. Jesus, keep us ever close. In your holy name, amen.
So once again, we don't have the screens, but if you know the song, join in when you know it, and if you don't know it, just enjoy and listen and pray.
I was asked that we would pray this evening for Isley as she's having a surgery this next week. So keep her in your prayers. What day is that again? Friday. And are there any other prayers among the congregation that would like to be shared this evening?
For all those high school graduates and college graduates that are
Yes, Eden.
Weston.
Yeah, Weston's elbow. Any others? Was there somebody having their hand up back there? Okay, all right, let's go to the Lord. Lord, thank you for this altar. Thank you for this place, a physical location in which that we can bow and know that you hear our prayers, that you are concerned with every intricate detail in our life, whether large or small. There's nothing that you don't care about that happens to us, Lord. Pray that you would be with those who were not able to come this evening but long to. Be with those who long to take part in the service but were not able to because of the online complications. Pray that you would be with Isley, Lord, as she has surgery this next week. May she heal well. May the surgery go well. And may it take care of whatever that needs to be healed there, Lord. Pray that you would be with the high school graduates, Lord, out of this area and those nearby, all of our family, friends that have high school graduates, Lord, lead and guide each one. And for those from this congregation, Lord, I pray that you would give them opportunity to be used by you, that you would call them where their feet stands to love you and to love others. Pray, Lord God, that you'd be with Weston and his elbow, help it to heal quickly, Lord. Be with all those who need the hand of healing. Be with the Atsit family and be with the List family, Lord, as they are in a time of mourning. May it be, Lord, that you comfort those who mourn. And so, Lord, we pray the prayer that you have taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Would you please rise and receive the benediction? Now may the God of peace himself sanctify you entirely. May your spirit and soul and body be preserved complete without blame at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now to the King, eternal, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. Let's join together as we conclude this service in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit by singing Knowing You, Jesus, number 894. peace and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.